Good morning, church. How are you today? Yes, good. I had one kid in Sunday school, then we had two more kids in Sunday school. So kind of a quiet morning this morning, so we decided to carry one of our own paralyzed to church today just to see how hard that would be. And there was more giggling than you would imagine. It's not in the Bible, but lots and lots of giggling when that was happening. Those five friends together were having a good time. I'm going to have a good time today. I'm going on a field trip with some of my friends from church, and it's not the little people this time, it's the seniors. So I brought my lunch because I'm going over to the community building after this worship service to eat. At 12:30, the bus is leaving to go, or it's a van. It's not a bus, it's a van. Down to St. John's Church. We're going to see that reenactment, do a little tour of the church, and then we're headed back home here to Broadus Church. So join me. I know the ones of you who are signed up. I've had questions about whether there's other tickets available. I'm not sure. Janet knows, and so I'm just kind of directing them to her, whether the two that we had are still available. You can, of course, come and buy your own ticket at St. John's Church. I'm sure it's not booked up. Also, youth are doing their finale for the summer, kind of their tribes thing. They're going to kind of get together and see who won, had the most points and stuff. That's between 2:30 and 4:30 today. Wednesday evenings start off on the 4th of September. It's like school is coming. It's going to be here, like next Monday. Is this right? Yes? Everybody? Yeah. People with kids are going, yes, yes, yes. Okay. Monday the 19th, school will start. Our Wednesday night programs are waiting on those until the 4th of September. But if you'll look in the back of the chairs, you'll see a blue card. It's not too early to start signing up for Wednesday nights. There'll be classes for everyone and meals as well. So pull those cards out and start taking a look at them. You can put them in the offering bag as you leave, please. Also, again, school starting. So 2 days after we start Wednesday nights, we'll have our first Fun Friday of the fall. That's on September the 6th. So the sign-up sheet is already out there. If you forget, please email me before Friday the 6th so I'll know how many kids are coming to eat and we'll have enough people to herd them and watch them and work with them. Okay? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father God, so much that we thank you for. There's just so much. What a beautiful day you have provided for us. This opportunity to come in here where it's nice and cool and to just worship you and to kind of remember that we can do that anytime, any place. But let's set this time aside now. We're here. You're here. Help us to find something new that you're trying to teach us today, not to just find it, but to grab hold of it and to apply it to our lives and make a change to become something more that you want us to be. Be with those that are leading worship today, also with Pastor Phil as he brings us the message. And then with our groups that are doing things today, this afternoon, help them to be enriching. And new changes would be made, new friendships would be born from those. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for your son, Jesus. And we pray this in his name. Amen.
Good morning. I hope you're happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I'd love to invite you to stand if you're able at this time and sing with us.
Better. Walk out your grave. Invite the children, come up with me for a moment. Children, plural. Oh, yay! Yay! All right, good to see you guys. I know a lot of people are traveling this time of year, but they're gonna come back. I brought a hat for you, right? Oh. Okay, so I have a couple things with me. One is an orange cone, and the other have caution tape. You are correct, it's caution tape. Where would you see like orange cones and maybe the caution tape too? Where? Oh, crime scenes. That would be a different children's message, but yes. You're right. Oh, perfect. She said, when people are building on the road, do y'all ever see like orange cones, and sometimes they're even big barrels, and they've got them all around, and of course they don't want you to go where they're working because it'd be kind of dangerous, right? Because sometimes they're digging holes and have big equipment and stuff like that. But right now in Mechanicsville, I mean, I know all the adults know, we have lots of road work going on, and sometimes I watch and I think, oh, when is this going to be finished? But you know what? It doesn't finish. It doesn't finish because, you know, they work on this intersection or on this road, but then they got to go to another road. A few years later, they got to go back to the same road and fix the potholes again. So there's always construction going on, meaning somebody is building something and making it better, okay? Fixing it and making it better. So God does that all the time. It never ends. God is always building us to make us better, to fix things that might be wrong in our lives. And so if God is working on somebody, like working in their heart, does he use caution tape? Yeah, no, we don't get to see it the same way. So you can't really tell it just by looking at somebody. But there's a verse in the Bible in Philippians 1 that says, he who began a good work in you, that means he is talking about God. God created you, and God is already working in you, but it says he who began that good work in you is going to carry it on until completion, until the day of Jesus Christ. When Jesus comes again, God is going to be working on us all the time until then. And that may be kind of scary because you think, oh, to have God working on us to change us, that might be a bad thing. But it's always a good thing. Because God wants to make us better. So I think that sometimes God might look at me and say, oh, you know, Phil, he's a pretty good guy, but you know, he needs to work on his patience. And so God will work on my patience a little bit. Or, oh, maybe need to work on Phil's generosity. And so always we need to be, you know, when we study the scripture, when we come to church, even when we're with our friends and our family, we need to be thinking, okay, what does God want me to do? What can I do better than I've done before? And God is helping us with that, to give us wisdom and to give us strength. And so I'm kind of glad that God never stops the construction process, that he never says, oh, Phil is useless. You know, he's not ever going to get any better. I'm not even going to worry about him anymore. But God, for each of us, is always interested in helping us to become more like Jesus. So when that's happening, you're not going to see the orange cones. You're not going to see the caution tape. You're not going to see men with the orange vests and the hard hats. It's not that kind of construction. But hopefully what you will see is little bits of difference happening. People helping other people, people forgiving each other, people being kind and generous. And when you see that, you can think, oh yeah, God's been at work. You know, that's really wonderful to see how he changes people's lives. So let's pray today and let's just thank God for never giving up on us and for always working in us through his Holy Spirit in order to make us who we should be. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you that you created us. You gave us families. You gave us friends. Just so many wonderful things in life. But you're never done working on us. You want us to be our best. You want us to be like Jesus, to be kind and to be loving and to be encouraging to other people and forgiving, maybe even when they hurt us. You want us to be holy and righteous. And so, Lord, we ask you to come into our hearts, that you would teach us new things every day, and we want to follow you and to know that your power is working in us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, thank you for coming up with me.
Good morning. I want to talk to you about the good life. For me, the good life, it could be, you know, 20 acres south of a beach in North Carolina. For me, the good life, it could be having a salary large enough to where my wife doesn't have to work. You know, maybe the good life might be different for each and every one of us, this idea of what is ideal. You know, when you know you've made it. But it doesn't matter what we think. What matters is what Scripture says. And so I want to read to you Matthew 6:33 real quick. I'll be reading from the CSB. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided to you. So we were at camp 2 weeks ago, roughly, and these students, they learned what the good life is. They learned that the good life is this idea of putting Christ before ourselves, before others. And really, when you put Christ before yourself and before others, well, all of these things will be given to you. All of the stress-free, the ideal, the good life, it will be given to you. And so I just want to take a moment. I want to hype up our youth group. We have worked at five different churches as their youth pastor in my time, whether it was an intern or whether I was actually on staff. And I haven't been to a church that has the idea of fellowship like this church has within the youth ministry. We have two campuses that blend together so well every single time we get together. I don't see any cliques. I don't see any exclusion. We just have a group that is very strong and united. And it's something that I'm very proud of for these students. So we're about to play a video, and it'll show you a small glimpse of the experience that these students had at camp. So I hope you enjoy it. Oh, and also, we recorded some interviews, and this will be posted later as an extended edition of this video, probably the end of the month, we'll say. So I hope you enjoy the video. Thank you.
I was at a loss until you found me. You gave me a home within your love. I was running blind until you showed me that life could be this good. I want all my friends to know about you. No matter what it takes, I'll never stop. Everything I am is for your glory. My life's forever yours. I found one love, can't control it. Hit me like a wildfire, send me emotion. Nothing else compares, losing all my cares. Now that I have found one love, one.
Now I'm running far within your freedom. I don't even care what they would say. Living in your presence is the reason I'll never be the same. I want all my friends to know about you. No matter what it takes, I'll never stop. Everything I am is for your glory.
Try to make them all think strong. Yeah, the friends will keep me home, says I ain't tired. But these tear-stained eyes ain't lying. It's hard. Nobody told me life could be so hard. Weary soul with a heart that's barely beating. But every time I get that feeling, I hit my knees on my head. Saying, dear Lord Jesus, you know I can't do this on my own. I can't do this on my own. Lord knows I try, but I'm good at falling down. Thank God you're good at picking me up off the ground. World's gonna try to break me, but I know the one who makes me strong.
Daddy always
a place you can always go when you got nothing. And then he handed me the one thing that's strong. Doesn't matter how old it gets, there's power in the words read in this old Bible. And when I'm desperate for revival,
notice how young the praise team got today. Keeping you young, isn't it, Ellis and Jamie? Yeah, that's good. I want to share with you this morning a story about a man named Jacob. And to understand his story, you need to know a little bit of his history, a little bit about where he came from, his upbringing. You see, this fellow Jacob was the son of a man named Isaac, making him then the grandson of Abraham. Abraham is known in the scripture as the father of God's people. He was called to leave his native land of Ur and then to move on from the area of Haran, where his father and the clan had settled, and to continue the journey through the barren wilderness of the Mesopotamia to a place called Canaan. And it was to Abraham, the grandfather, that God had made a personal promise and a covenant. And we see that in Genesis chapter 12, verses 2 and 3, where God speaks to Abraham and says, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." Now, Abraham was not a perfect man. His behavior wasn't perfect. His faith wasn't perfect. But the Bible tells us he did believe God. He trusted God. And that enabled him to have a right relationship with him. To Abraham and his wife Sarah, both of them, when they were well beyond normal child-bearing years, to them was given the promise of a son. And that son then was born Isaac. It was Isaac who Abraham was willing to sacrifice on an altar to God, if God wanted that. But God didn't want Isaac dead. He wanted the faith of Abraham to live on through him and then live on through their descendants as well. Now, when it was time for Isaac to marry, Abraham knew that a wife should not be chosen from among the pagan tribes of the land where they were living. A wife should come from among Abraham's tribe in the old land, people who would share some concept of the Almighty Living God. But Abraham was not willing for Isaac to go back there, thinking that he might want to stay. He wasn't going to risk Isaac being sucked back into the way things used to be, so he sent a servant who went away and came back with the bride-to-be, Rebecca. Now, there seemed to be a real love between Isaac and Rebecca. They had a couple of sons together, twins, you might remember. Esau was the first of the twins to arrive in the world, but little Jacob was right behind him. In fact, he was holding on to Esau's heel as if to try to pull him back and take first place for himself. That's actually how he got the name Jacob, which means the heel grabber or the tripper or figuratively the trickster. And Jacob kind of lived up to that especially in his early life. Jacob and Esau were from the same gene pool, but they were anything but identical twins. Esau grew to be what we might call a man's man. He was strong. He was hairy. He was a skilled hunter. He loved the outdoors. And though he wasn't always overly bright or even spiritually attuned, he was still his father Isaac's favorite. Jacob, on the other hand, was slighter, smooth-skinned, and he liked the kitchen more than being out in the woods. He became his mother Rebecca's favorite. Now, he had intelligence for sure, but his more spiritual side was pretty well masked in his early years by kind of a devious nature. By tradition, both the family birthright, which means that one of the sons would become the head of the family and would get extra inheritance because of that, and then also the family blessing, the spiritual blessing, those would normally go to the eldest son. But the scripture tells us that Esau gave away his birthright to Jacob for a bowl of stew. And when Isaac was ready to give the family blessing to Esau, Rebekah, his wife, devised a plan, and she did it with Jacob in order to steal away that blessing. Jacob went before his old blind father dressed in animal fur. And so he felt hairy and he smelled outdoorsy, let's say. And sure enough, fooled his dad into blessing him, the younger son. But strange as it may seem to us, God had a plan to work through all of this family intrigue to make Jacob into a man that he could use. And so we find this dysfunctional family. Isaac played favorites and was kind of losing control of his family. Rebecca played favorites and she tricked her husband to get her way. Esau was mad as a hornet that he had lost both his birthright and his family blessing. And in his anger, Esau vowed that he was going to kill Jacob, but he was going to wait till his father died before he did it. And so, there we have Jacob, who was now running scared for his life, actually. To get him out of town and to keep him safe, Rebecca devised a story that she was going to send him back to Haran in order to find his own wife. So off he went. And look where his conniving plans had gotten him. He's on the run. He doesn't have family with him anymore, seemingly doesn't even have servants with him on this journey. He's alone, he's scared, he's walking through some godforsaken wilderness, or at least it may have seemed forsaken by God. So I want you, if you have your Bible or you can follow along on the screen, we're going to read part of this passage from Exodus I'm sorry, from Genesis. I marked Exodus. Let me go to Genesis chapter 28. I'm going to read you the wrong passage. So we're going to Genesis chapter 28, and we're going to start in verse 10. It says this, Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. And when he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go. And I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. And when Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. Surely the Lord was in this place, and I was not aware of it. Jacob is at the end, it seems, of his first day's journey. He's traveling north through some pretty barren and desolate country. This fact is driven home by a description of his sleeping arrangements. He propped his head to sleep on a rock, on a stone. I would think surely a bundle of grass would have been more comfortable, or even a piece of wood. But I think he used what was available, a rock. He must have been worn out. His emotions were spent, his body was tired. And because he's in that strange, desolate place with his head upon a rock, even then, he was able to fall asleep. That's how tired he was. And in his sleep came the dream that would change his life. There's a flight of stairs, or we sometimes call it Jacob's ladder, don't we? It's from a Hebrew word meaning to rise up. So either one fits the description. And the bottom is resting on the earth, and the top is stretching, we would assume, into the clouds. And there are angels walking up and down. And then God himself appears at the top, looking down on the activity of his angels, but then speaking directly to Jacob. And he gives him a recommitment of the promise that he had first given to Abraham and then given to Isaac, his father, as well. It was a promise that this would one day be the land of their descendants. It was a reminder that though he would go to Haran for a while, it was not going to be his home. This wilderness of Canaan is where God would use Jacob. This is also the confirmation that the lineage of promise would pass through Jacob and not Esau. Though he didn't have any children yet and wasn't even married, descendants were going to come, and they would become a great nation. Also, with the promise of being blessed was the purpose of being a blessing to the world. Well, when Jacob woke up, he understood that something extraordinary had happened to him during the night. God had come to him in a dream, and we might have said, oh, it's just a dream. But Jacob understood that he had been in the presence of God. So he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I've been missing it. I haven't been realizing that God was right here with me. You know, I can only imagine how true that is of us. How many times is God right there with us, God wanting to teach us something, God wanting to put us to work somehow, and we're not even realizing that God is there. Well, all of a sudden, the place where Jacob is looks different to him. It no longer looks so desolate. He says something along the lines of, this place is awe-inspiring. This is a great place. It seems to me like a sanctuary, like the house of God, which gives entrance to heavenly things. He named the place Bethel, which means the house of God. In the morning, Jacob took his stone pillow and he set it up as an altar to God. And he promised that with God's blessing, he would one day return to that spot, that lonely, desolate, God-forsaken spot, and he would make it a place of worship. So what do we learn so many thousands of years later? What do we learn from this story about Jacob? Well, one, we learn that God works in some strange and desolate places. In Jacob's dream, the angels ascending and descending there on that staircase, it teaches us something. It says God's at work there. The angels are God's workmen, if you will. They are his messengers. And so that picture of them says God has a plan here. He's already at work, even though it looks like nothing is happening. It seemed like a strange place for that vision to take place. It's been some years, but I recall once talking to a man who had been a former soldier and he had fought in the Korean War. Now, many or most of you know that I grew up in South Korea, the child of missionaries there. But he was telling me about it, and it was the worst of times. He had really seen nothing of the beauty of Korea because there was only death and destruction. He referred to Korea as the armpit of the Orient. But I kind of, you know, tried to be a little forgiving of that slur of a place that I loved, because I realized that I had seen the beautiful part, but for the moment in history he was there, it was awful. Well, guess what? God decided to work in that desolate place. He decided to work where there had been death and destruction, where all the trees had been blown down by bombs. And God moved in, and not only did the people flourish, the gospel flourished in South Korea. And South Korea has become one of the greatest missionary sending countries that the world has ever known. God does stuff like that. He finds the hurting places of the world, the desolate places of the world, and he says, you know, I'm going to do something good here. Now, early in the 20th century, a young Albanian girl named Agnes felt the call to be a missionary. She was always fascinated by the stories that she had heard of India, so she set her sights upon that place. So deep was her passion that she followed with the commitments and the training to become a nun. And she got her wish, and she was stationed in India, where initially she was a school teacher. But she found in that country things that deeply moved her heart. Not just about the cultural heritage or the landscape or the architecture. What moved her were the deep hurts and needs of so many people, especially in and around Calcutta. The haves lived pretty well. The have-nots were ravaged by plague and famine. There was violence between Muslims and Hindus. It was fairly common. Orphans would wander the streets. Old and sick people were sometimes brought out beside the road and just left to die. Starving people were digging through garbage trying to find food. But she realized something important. She realized that God was at work in that strange and desolate place. Some of you have been exposed to places like that. Some years ago, we had a team, and I got to go with the team. Amber and I both did. Went down to South Africa. And we remember, we saw some of the townships, but we remember talking with some girls who would actually rent out their bodies, trying to pay for their school fees. Does God work there? That's a tough place to be, but He does. Some of you have been to Native American communities around this country, out in the West, where there's so much poverty and so much alcoholism. On an annual basis, members of our church work on houses right here in Hanover that have no indoor plumbing. They get their water from a well. And it's not even reported, because if it is reported, the homes get shut down and then they're homeless. And that's right here in our own county. But don't be surprised to learn that God is already at work in those places. And He may be preparing a spot for us to be involved. Because what we learn is that it's God's prerogative to call us into the work with Him. Agnes, that I told you about, who went to India, she heard God's call. She took her religious vows to be a nun. She chose the name of a Catholic patron saint of missionaries, Teresa. And so Sister Teresa, we later knew her as Mother Teresa of Calcutta. And she organized the missionaries of charity who vowed to care for the poorest of the poor. They planted clinics. They established living places, kind of refuge homes for people with leprosy who were cast out of their own houses. They built homes for orphans. They even built homes for the terminally ill so that they would have a place to die with dignity. In 1979, Mother Teresa received the Nobel Peace Prize. In much the same way, it was God's prerogative to call Moses back to Egypt. And it was God's prerogative to call Jonah to go to Nineveh, a place he didn't want to go. And so He can call you too. It may not be Calcutta. It may not be to an Indian reservation in South Dakota. It may not be to the poorest county in Appalachia, though, folks, it may be. But maybe your call will be to a lonely person in a nursing home. Maybe your call will be to some of your neighbors who are hungry. Or maybe your call will be into a prison ministry, or to people who can't afford their home repairs. Or maybe your call is to someone who's never been invited to church before. God is already at work. You're not going to do a thing for God that God hadn't already been preparing. And maybe it's a place where God already has messengers, has His people or His angels preparing the way. The Spirit is at work. We wonder what we can do in such circumstances as these. But we learn that God gives us everything we need to be a blessing to other people. Jacob probably didn't realize it at the time, but God was equipping him to bless the world. He would soon be the patriarch of a family with 12 sons. Through one of them, named Joseph, the nation of Egypt and the surrounding countries and even Jacob's own family were saved from starvation. And through the lineage of another of the sons named Judah, the Messiah would one day come, offering God's salvation to the whole world. You might think that you really have nothing to offer God, that there's nothing special about you that He could use to make a difference in the world. But if you think that, you're wrong. Ephesians 2:10 says this: "We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. God had prepared a good work for Jacob, and he has also prepared a good work for each of us. And like Jacob, we have his promise and we have his presence. And with God, those two things are really very much the same. God may call you to bless others by encouraging them, by making some phone calls or sending some emails. Or God may call you to tell people how the love of Jesus has changed your life. He may have a place for you feeding the hungry or visiting the sick. He may want you to plug into existing ministries, things that are already set up and you just have to become a volunteer to help out. Or he may call you to start some new ministry. It may be something that you do here, or God may call you to another place, maybe even another country. But don't be scared. No matter how distant, how desolate, how difficult, you won't be alone because God is already there. In following God's plan for our lives, we are forever blessed. Jacob discovered that day who he was meant to be and what he was meant to do. It gave his life purpose. It gave his life meaning. In following God's leading for your life, you're going to find the same thing. You're going to find that you are blessed now, and you will be blessed by God for eternity. My prayer today is that God will open up our spiritual eyes to the greatness of his divine activity around us, and that we will know the place where we are supposed to plug in. And then wherever we are, we'll be able to honestly say with those words of Jacob, "Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place, and I wasn't aware of it before." But now that we are aware of it, what are we going to do? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we look at our lives, we already know your blessings. We know the abundance of what we have. We know the beauty of this place where we live. We know the friendship of people around us and the blessings of family. But Lord, there are also places in the world, there are circumstances that are hard. They are unpleasant sometimes. They are desolate. Sometimes it even looks hopeless to us. But that's only through our power, because your power can accomplish anything. And so, Heavenly Father, it's hard for us to do, but we come today submitting our lives to you, asking that you would take us and use us to do what you want us to do at whatever cost, knowing that even when it's hard, it's always the best thing. It's the thing that brings the greatest joy into our lives. And so, Heavenly Father, let us work with you. Guide us, empower us, and help us to leave this world a better place than how we found it. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I think what's hard for us when we give ourselves to God and say, okay, take me, do what you want with me. What's hard is to trust that what he calls us to do is actually best, because we have some preconceived notions. But even the song we're going to sing in closing today, Trust and Obey, is a good reminder that in trusting God, it means we obey him. And then when we obey him, we reap the fruit of his almighty blessings in our lives. While we're singing today, if the Lord lays on your heart a decision that you want to share with me or with the church family, I'll be here at the front, and you're welcome to come and to do that. I invite you to stand with me as we sing Trust and Obey.
pray together. Lord, we thank you so much for the gift of this day and for the gift of this church family, Lord, and for the opportunity that we have to worship your name freely together. Lord, we pray that you would give us your wisdom and guidance as you call us into spaces and situations that we might not expect to find ourselves in, but knowing that you are doing a good thing. Lord, we pray that you would remind us of that confidence we have, that you have equipped us and will continue to equip us so that we can show your love and your mercy to those around us each day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.